Yeah, we're looking forward to it. Putting in a good few hard yards there in the pre-season. We know got a big ask against Clontarf, but we're looking forward to it Friday night.
Yeah, so we've got a live stream. It's the opening game of the season. Hoping to get a big crowd?
Yeah, hoping to get a big crowd in the bowl. Numbers picking up at the end of last year, so first game of the season. I know Clontarf always bring a good few over from Castle Avenue, so I'm expecting a big crowd in the day.
In terms of performance last year, were you happy with what you did and achieved?
Not really, to be honest. Like, we finished mid-table. It's not really acceptable, and we're looking to push forward this year, maybe get in the top four spot and secure the playoff place.
Have you changed anything?
We've got new coaching staff in this year. Obviously, new captain, and there's a few new personnel in.
Good evening and welcome to the first weekend of the 2015-16 Ulster Bank League season. Tonight we are in Belfield Park for the Division 1A fixture between UCD and Clontarf. With me as always is Dermot O'Mahony, the Leinster branch administrator. Dermot, these two clubs have already met in the Leinster Senior Cup with college winning 12-3. How do you see tonight shaping up in these rather damp conditions?
Yeah, I think conditions are going to play a big part, Gordon. There are two of the better teams, not alone in Leinster, but in the country. Normally, a bright attacking game plan would be what we expect from UCD, the conditions are extremely testing, and I'm going to go for Clontarf, narrowly beaten last year in the final, winners the year before, to maybe edge it.
Okay, well, we'll see how good your local knowledge is. Both sides in reasonable strength here. College obviously missing some players away with Leinster. Referee tonight is Sean Gallagher, the newly appointed RFU referee, development officer based over in Galway. Fine referee, referees in the B&I Cup. And Clontarf have started trying to play the ball. It's a poor pass there, goes backwards. And the first penalty tonight, Sean Gallagher penalises UCD for not releasing after the tackle.
It was a bad pass back to Evan Ryan in the centre. He managed to rescue it well. The result is a penalty for Clontarf, which they're out half. Joey Carberry, who played with the Irish under-20s earlier this summer in the Junior World Cup. It's a touchdown to far side inside the 10-metre line. Attacking line out for Clontarf.
Of course, Dermot, Joey Carberry played actually with UCD last season. But of course, they have Ross Byrne, who's on the bench for Leinster tomorrow night. So colleagues don't have him, but he felt his chances would be limited here, and Leinster moved him across to Clontarf.
Line-out is turned over. It was won initially by Clontarf, but it's cleared down the far side and into the Clontarf 22. Back there, the Clontarf backs decide to run it. Mick McGrath, who played a good number of games with Leinster last year, boots it clear, but it's Billy Dardis who returns it for UCD up to about 10 metres outside the Clontarf 22.
It's good to see Nick McCarthy back at scrum half for UCD. Of course, he was captain of the Irish under-20 side, the Junior World Cup in Italy during the summer, and he had to come home with an injured shoulder. So it's good to see him back. Yes. Leinster Academy player as he is.
Still UCD going through the phases, testing out the Clontarf defence, which has been solid so far. A nice little offload where I think the referee deemed it to have gone backwards as it reached the receiver.
I think he may have deemed it actually off his shins there, but not off his hand. Clontarf defence very strong. UCD are driving around the side, not making a lot of progress at this point in time. Oh,
that was big.
Great hit by Clontarf for defence there. You can hear that on the far side of the ground.
Mick McGrath came very close to intercepting that, and I think if he got it, he was gone.
It was a 5-2 overlap for UCD coming left, and Mick McGrath read it very well. And I think you're right. Man who scored a number of tries for Leinster in the last couple of years looks very powerful. And of course, he's already played for Leinster this season, Dermot, in the pre-season friendlies.
He has indeed, yeah. And I suppose it was an ill-advised pass by the out-half, Jamie Glynn, for UCD. And as you mentioned, UCD are short quite a few players. A lot of their Leinster players are away on duty, including Adam Byrne, Gary Ringrose making his debut for Leinster on the wing tomorrow, Ross Byrne. And then there's some others who are, Josh Van de Flyer is in the back row, Dan Levy is there, and a few other players, James Tracy, Jeremy Lockman are on standby. So it's quite a number of players to be,
and
to
Ross
be with.
Ross Maloney is also starting, I think, tomorrow night, and Gavin Thornby is injured. So all in all, we reckon there's about 9 Leinster Academy stroke development players who are actually missing from the UCD side tonight, which is a huge loss for any side. And it's one of the problems that UCD have throughout the season, is they're never quite sure what side they're going to have. It all depends on who Leinster will release. And it does lead to a lot of disruption. And therefore, the results every year seem to ebb and flow.
Well, I suppose this year, because of the Rugby World Cup, and with 17 Leinster players, if you include the player with South Africa, whose name escapes me, there's 17 Leinster players on World Cup duty. So
Zane Kirshner.
Zane Kirshner, thank you. So it's
I was a senile moment for you.
Yeah, one of many. But it's, yeah, so I think this is going to be probably the nucleus of the UCD team for the next 4 to 6 weeks.
This first scrum of the evening, I think. Be interesting here. Clontarf, of course, with almost a new front row from last year's final. Ivan Sirocco was playing all right, but Turlough Considine and Dylan Doyle have come in for Brian Byrne and Royce Burke Flynn. They're also missing Ian Hurst, who's been injured. They're hoping he might be back in the next week or two. Whereas their back five is as played in the final last season. And Sean Gallagher penalises UCD for not holding it steady at the start, not getting the ball in. So it was a quick tap penalty by Clontarf, who will drive it forward and test the UCD tackling. There's a fine pass away there by Dermot O'Mara, who is playing scrum half this year. Last year, Sam Cronin was the captain and scrum half for Clontarf. He's not available tonight, but he will be available to them. Wide kick by UCD.
Fielded by Billy Dardis, who clears it, but only as far as Joey Carberry, who's running it back and has got close to halfway. And it's, I suppose, so far it's a feeling out process on both sides.
Yes, the game hasn't got into either 22 yet. It's been played very much actually within the Clontarf half so far. We've rarely had to look to our left, but here's got a good chance for Clontarf now. 4-1, that's a well-timed tackle. Tom Fletcher came in off his wing there. He saw the danger. There was a three-man overlap there. A good kick through by Dermot O'Mara down towards the goal line. It's going to stop short. Tom Fletcher's back, and he's had to carry it over his line. He's tackled over the line, and that will be a 5-metre scrum. Yep. Sean Gallagher signals that the ball's held up over the line. It's been carried over by Tom Fletcher. And now Clontarf have a very good attacking position. 5 metres going, and it was Mick McGrath, who was up very quickly in his opposite number there, to make that tackle.
Yeah, it was a fine kick through, and certainly Tom Fletcher did well to field it and to rescue it, but it stopped in that horrible territory for a defender, 5 metres from the goal line, slippery conditions, and I suppose he was meat and drink for Mick McGrath when he did arrive and forced him over. So we have an attacking 5 metre scrum for Clontarf. First really good, strong attacking position of either team this evening.
And so it's Dermot O'Mara to feed the scrum. Be interesting to see the last scrum. UCD were penalised for not holding a steady. Will this be a better one? Sean Gallagher is not happy. No, it's gone down. Both sides, both front rows, they will have been talked to beforehand about what the referee wants, about pushing straight, strong bind, arms up, but front rows being front rows, Dermot, they will do their own thing.
Yeah, they sure will, but it'll be interesting to see what Clontarf have planned here. Tony Ryan, their number 8, is with the on a short-term contract with Leinster. So I'm sure he'll be central to whatever move they have. Ryan was.
And if you look also during the position of Mick McGrath, he's on the inside shoulder of Joey Carberry. Now, will he be the dummy runner or to try and distract the college guys? The scrum is wheeled slightly around. Good scrum by UCD. Carberry pops, he pops to the centre. Now they're going right. Oh, a poor pass. And UCD almost came away with that. It was a poor pass by Clontarf, which went to ground. And now UCD kicked long, but was well held up. And now Tarf will start to counter from the halfway line.
Nice floated pass by Carberry. But unfortunately for him, it was a judge forward by the referee. Probably, I think, with a little help from his touch judge on the far side, who was very well positioned. And we have a scrum now for UCD.
I think Clontarf could feel maybe slightly peeved by that decision. That looked reasonably flat. We have the benefit, Dermot, of a screen here, which is a few seconds delayed from the actual play. And that did look as if it was a fairly flat pass.
Anyway, we have a scrum. And it's Sean Gallagher again setting the two sets of forwards. I think UCD be happy with the way that they defended the scrum on their own goal line. So now they have a chance to win their own ball and set their own backs into space and see what they can create.
Now the second free kick of the game, that goes to UCD this time for a slight movement by Clontarf at the scrum. The referee trying to set a standards. We don't want a night that's going to be ruined by scrummages. A strong tackle by Clontarf from the far side of the field. But UCD have retained the ball. Tarf are up quickly in defence. A good pick-up. That pass could have gone wider. There was men spare for UCD. Oh, quick ball away from McCarthy. They kicked long through Jamie Glynn. Good kick down. And UCD number four, Brian Cawley, fields the ball, puts it back inside, and UCD clear to touch.
Yeah, it was a bit of kick tennis there with some good kicking from both sides. Carberry put a good kick down. Cawley defended it well, and I think it was the scrum half, was it?
No, it was Barry Daly, the left winger for UCD, who'd come across to take the inside pass from Cawley and relieve the pressure. That's unlucky for Clontarf, throw to the back. The ball seemed to have been set up well, but obviously it's a wet night, and despite the fact we have ball boys around the ground here drying the ball, that one went to ground, and now it's going to be a scrum to UCD. The referee is talking to the front rows again. I think his patience will run out now. He's given a free kick to each side. I think the directive to referees these days, Dermot, would be that after a free kick, next time you go to a full penalty.
Yeah, that's it. So it'll be interesting to see, would the players react to the referees' two early free kicks, or will they continue in their in their own little way and incur the wrath of the referee.
And that is a good steady scrum. UCD have done well. Get the ball away. McCarthy has a quick look. Then feeds it out. They have a long skip pass. Stephen Murphy, the captain, makes good ground. There, Clontarf.
It had the appearances of a dangerous tackle, but I think he got him to ground okay. But it had all the hallmarks of one that was going to end up in trouble.
Yes, when you see the feet of the player past the horizontal, they're always extremely worried. Holly's keeping it close now. Now they spin it wide. They kick for the corner down to our right-hand side here, and it's found touch just outside the 22.
Yeah, it was their skipper, Stephen Murphy, who made the break the far side. He put in the kick into the right hand, down the right hand flank, and it's gone into touch on the 22, and it'll be a defensive line out for Clontarf. So Turlough Considine with the throw, finds his man, Captain Ben Riley, gone to ground.
It was a very good challenge by Brian Cawley, that line which didn't quite come off.
I think UCD may have certainly caused some problems. I'm not sure if they turned it over. Well, they're getting the scrum, so it was good upsetting by UCD. They certainly got in amongst them there.
Yeah, Thomas Byrne, the Clontarf second row, was taking exception to the UCD tight head, Liam Highland, holding his ankle off the side of that ruck, which for a moment looked that it could lead to something. And it's interesting, Darren, that Thomas Byrne, the second row, is the brother of Ed and Brian Byrne, the twin prop forwards. It's been unusual to see two guys in the front row and then have another one in the second row, though he doesn't look the tallest second row in the world, but very abrasive.
Slightly different body shape as well for his twin brothers, who are two fine players. Went through Clongowes and are now with Leinster, and we have a penalty, so the referee's patience has eventually given in, and he's given a penalty to Clontarf. Certainly very kickable, although it's not a night for kicking. Well, I suppose it is for the kicking, but maybe not for accurate kicking. It's slippery conditions. There's a little breeze. There's a breeze blowing, but it's probably favouring UCD, isn't it, Gordon? It's.
I would think so. Yeah, it's difficult to tell from where we're sitting here. It is. It's one of the best places from a comfy point of view. We have a box right on the halfway line. This was. You may remember, Dermot, they had the women's seven-a-side qualifiers here a few weeks ago, and they had the comfy box here, and they also built a tent around as well, which the disciplinary personnel sat in. So now UCD kicking for goal. It's Conal Doherty, that's centre, left-footed centre. From just outside the 20, it's the right side for him to curl it in. And will this be the opening points? Seems to have curled it well. It's through. That's the first points of the night in the Ulster Bank League here in Belfield. UCD go ahead by 3-0. And the run of play might just about have deserved it. Most of the play has been in the Clontarf half, except for the couple times Tarf got down the far end.
Yeah, it was a lovely, beautifully struck penalty by Conal Doherty, who hails from Derry. So players from all over the country here in UCD, of course. And the kickoff is fielded inside the 22 by UCD, and it's by their number eight,
Shane Grinnell.
Shane Grinnell, yeah.
He's made good ground. Now Nick McCarthy with the box kick. Rob Keogh takes it well. Rob, of course, who unfortunately got injured in the All-Ireland final last year. He was had played extremely well. Kickball, he was carrying a knee coming into the final. I was unlucky that he hit the post, which would have been the match-winning score for Clontarf in that final. Good try forward there by Ivan Sirocco. Or Sirocca. And now Adrian Darcy showing the footwork of his brother, who currently contracted with Munster, but has been turned over after that. UCD, they're going to draw the man now, put in space. But Clontarf have grabbed the cross very well and snuffed out what should have been a good chance there for UCD. McCarthy feeds it away to Glynn again. And I must say, Dermot, Clontarf's line speed and defence is very good.
Yeah, they nullified that chance here on the right flank very well indeed. And then they were up to force UCD to concede 10 yards for the next phase. So, yeah, very impressive defence. And a good clearance to touch then to boot.
That was by Robert McGrath, who, of course, is the brother of Magic Mick on the other wing. It's unusual. We have two brothers playing in the wing. Robert is reputed to have the same electric pace as his brother. The product of Barnhall, where he was top try scorer with Barnhall for a couple of seasons in divisions 2A and 2B.
Bingo. collapsing them all, called by the referee. So it's a chance for college probably to go up the line. I would imagine it's not kickable from that range in these conditions. And Doherty again to nudge it up the line.
Yep. Good strike. There's a fine take by Brian Coley at the last line-out, who is in the second row with Emmett McMahon, who was last year's captain of UCD. He's actually finished his studies now in UCD. He's teaching in St. Michael's, but he's opted to have an additional year playing for the college before possibly moving on elsewhere.
Well, we have another crooked in, so we're going to have another scrum, but I think Sean Gallagher, the referee, needs to have a word with the two packs, or at least separate them. So,
as they say, Dermot, a bit of silly business. And Karen Moran, commonly known as Lego, has been spoken to by the referee there. Nothing too serious, so the initial offence of the crooked throw has given Clontarf a line-out 30 metres out from their own line, playing into a slight wind.
So let's see how the scrums go this time. There's been a number of free kicks and a penalty kick, so O'Mara with the feed for Tarf.
Good scrum by College. They had the nudge. Yes, and very much Andrew Porter, the Leinster sub-academy player, has seemed very much got the upper hand against Dylan Doyle, the new Clontarf tight head. Doyle was penalised earlier on, and he's been penalised there again. He couldn't take the pressure from Porter, who, of course, is an Irish under 20 international and a product, if memory serves me right, of King's Hospital, Dermot.
He is indeed, and it's all that gives Doherty another shot at goal, not a million miles away from where he successfully kicked the opening penalty, and he's a chance now to double the lead for College. And while he's lining up the kick, Gordon, I think maybe we just might talk about Division 1A, and there's been a lot of changes in the Ulster Bank League, and Division A was a very successful league last year. There was a lot of teams in contention, relegation, playoffs, right up until the very end.
I think, Dermot, that in bringing back the playoffs to the league, it certainly added considerable more interest to it. It kept more clubs interested at the top end of the league. Just watch, here's his kick, but has Doherty pushed it past the far post? He has. He started that one too wide. He thought the wind was going to blow it back. Yes, we brought the playoffs back in last season. They're now back into all divisions this season, playoffs for promotion. But in the Division 1A, it's the top four clubs qualify for the semi-finals. Last year, Lansdowne hosted Young Munster in one of them, and I saw the first half of that game in on the main pitch in the Aviva Stadium, and it actually went to extra time. And in fairness, Young Munster brought a huge crowd to the game and created a fantastic atmosphere. As College go right here now, again they had the overlap, but unfortunately it was a second row and a prop were out wide, so the pace wasn't there. Mick McCarthy tried to put a man through a gap there, was knocked on. Referee Sean Gallagher playing advantage. And if Tarf can get this ball, they have seen the men coming left here. They are coming left. Spinning well, Rob Keown and Mick McGrath, who has the pace to go around his man. He's chipped ahead down the left-hand side. McGrath's taken it. And that is a fantastic score. That'll be one of the best tries Dermot will see in the league all season. It came from a knock-on in midfield. Clontarf spun the ball wide. A very good piece of hands by Rob Keough to send Mick McGrath away. McGrath down the left-hand wing, chipped over the top, regained the bounce, and then held off the defending tackler for what must have been about 10 yards into the corner. Tremendous strength from McGrath.
If ever a nickname lived up to its billing, it was Magic Mick as he scored in the left-hand corner there, because it was a scintillating try. It was just pure magic. It was well worked out to the left-hand side by Clontarf. They took advantage of a prop forward who was after losing a boot. They got the ball out to McGrath. He skinned another man, kicked the ball over his opposing winger, gathered, and as you say, carried another defender at least 10 yards to touchdown. And now it's Joey Carberry with the chance to convert and extend a 5-3 lead to 4 points.
I'm just trying to think back to the Ulster Bank League awards night at the end of the season, Dermot. I'm not sure, do they have an award for the try of the season? As the conversion goes just left of the post and wide. But certainly if there is an award for try of the season, that in the first half an hour of our season is going to be one of the top contenders throughout the season.
A fantastic try. Yes, it's definitely, it reminds me many years ago of Manchester United in the old match of the day scenario when Beckham on the opening day of the season chipped from the halfway line for an unbelievable goal. So Magic Mick does something similar from the halfway line. Fantastic
try. I didn't realise, Dermot, you were that old. You can remember that far back.
Gordon, you were telling me about that recently.
Touché. Now, has that galvanised Clontarf? On a wet night, they showed very good hands. And Carberry is moving the ball on their way. Oh, it's forward pass. A forward pass, and it looked as if Michael Brown, a great servant of Clontarf through the years, as if he might have been away there. But Sean Gallagher, directly in line, has called the forward pass. But Clontarf, Dermot, are certainly, even in these wet and what one would say miserable conditions, although it's not that cold, thankfully, they're showing great enterprise in trying to move the ball, especially from right to left.
Yeah, I mean, they have a good back line. I mean, that's obviously evident. They have the McGrath brothers on either wing. Rob Keogh, from fullback from last year's team. Joey Carberry to pull the strings at out half from last year's Irish under-20s. They're certainly showing tremendous potential in the opening, 20 minutes, 25 minutes?
And of course they're missing Matt Darcy, who their captain last year in centre, who's on a short-term contract with Munster during the Rugby World Cup.
Yeah, I think they might be missing a few other players as well. So I suppose, like all teams, early season, injuries, unavailability for whatever. But certainly they've set the world on fire here already. That's still the bit of buzzing after that fantastic score.
A try to live in the memory bank, Dermot.
Privilege of being here to watch it.
Well, hopefully those that are watching at home and abroad really enjoyed that score. Because I think it made for good television here. There's a lovely bright setting here in Belfield. It's a very, very good viewing conditions. And again, the UCD pack have steamrolled through Clontarf there. And this must be a worry for Clontarf, who, of course, as we said earlier on, are missing Burt Flynn, Hurst, and Brian Byrne. And even though Ivan Soroka is a strong player, he can't do it all on his own.
It's been an impressive scrummaging start by that UCD forward pack. I mean, they've caused problems. That's their third penalty now. They've been very impressive. Strong front row, big second rows, Gordon.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what Clontarf do here, Dermot. Obviously, Dylan Doyle at tight head is in trouble. Will they bring on their replacement prop, David Moore, the youngster David Moore, 40 years young? This time, Conal Doherty just swings the penalty in by the far post to give the lead back to UCD, 6 points to 5, as we approach the half-hour mark in this game.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see, is young Dave Moore going to appear? Because certainly Tarf are in trouble in the scrum.
Fine take by Emmett McMahon there. Usually drive it forward, but Thomas Byrne got in there and disrupted that quite legally. McCarthy goes airborne again. Mick McGrath comes forward for Clontarf, takes it. You always expect him in situations that they're just a career down the left wing.
It was a beautiful take. He actually took it with his fingers. We were right beside his take, and his take was he took it with his fingers. But it's a penalty against Clontarf. despite that fantastic take in the air, it's a penalty at the breakdown against Tarf, and a chance for Doherty to nudge the ball up the right flank again.
It was Tony Ryan, the Clontarf number 8, who drove forward. Tony is on a short-term Leinster training contract during the Rugby World Cup as cover for the provincial side, but he drove forward there, but the college jackal was in very quickly and he was penalised for not releasing. When that gives UCD now a line out just outside the Clontarf 22.
So Sean McNulty with the throw, Irish under 20. Ball goes back, UCD lose it. It's taken by Matt Darcy, I think, to Magic Mick. And off goes McGrath again, brought down at the halfway line. Clontarf would seem to have numbers. Carberry makes a break. Gets the ball away in the tackle. Still Clontarf possession over the far side.
Big good progress, but a very well read there by Stephen Murphy, the UCD captain. In very quickly. A long kick down.
And Billy Dardis, I think that was the fullback with the clearance. So two Kildare players. Billy from Neas, fullback for UCD, and Joey Carberry is from Athy. He went to Rock after impressing at youth level with Athy and with underage teams in Leinster, and played SCT with Blackrock College before graduating to UCD and now on to Clontarf, and of course Irish under 20s on the way.
Fine take the back of the line there by Carl Moran for Clontarf, but UCD have stolen that. But unfortunately, as so happens so often during the modern game, player breaks off on his own, is tackled, and then he gets penalised, and then UCD had a few verbals after it at the referee as they disagreed with the decision, and he's marching back 10 yards back to the UCD 10 metre line, and there was an injury to a UCD player over the far side. Sean Gallagher has stop play.
Yes, it was an excellent steal by McMahon, but as you rightly say, he got isolated, and the jackals were there from Clontarf, and the referee penalised them for not releasing. And again, maybe we'll just go back to the earlier chat we were having about the AIL, and it's restructured down the divisions this season, Gordon, isn't it? You might expect.
Yes, Division 1A and 1B last year were teams of 10 divisions playing, 10 teams playing home and away, a total of 18 matches. And after an AIL review a couple of years ago, the rest of the sections were also divided into 10-team leagues. So now we have 5 divisions of 10, with all clubs playing home and away within those leagues. In Division 1A, as we've already said, the top 4 will play off for the title. The bottom club gets relegated. And in an interesting addition to the league, and I hope I get this right now from the top of my head, the 9th place team will play in Division 1A, will play the 4th place team in 1B, and the 2nd and 3rd place teams in 1B will also play off. The winners of those two matches will then play off in a final for the final position in Division 1A next season. So I hope I haven't complicated that too much for you. Basically, it's 9 versus 4, 2v3, the winners meeting then in the final for the last place in Division 1A next season. That is then replicated throughout the divisions, all the way down through. So it's the same at the bottom of 1B, 2A, 2B, down to the bottom of 2C, where the bottom club will be relegated and replaced by the winner of the provincial qualifying league championship, between the 4 provincial league champions, and the runner-up in that division in the Provincial League Championship will play off against the second last team in Division 2C. And we've managed to get all that in while Joey Carberry is lining up this penalty attempt from the 10-metre line. with about 7 minutes to go and injury time. It looks a good kick, and it is over. It's a fine kick by Joey Carberry. And Dermot, Joey Carberry kicked very, very well for the Irish under-20s in the Junior World Cup during the summer. I think in the first match, he kicked, was it 6 out of 6, before being replaced by Quinlan from Cork Con, who kicked that incredible penalty from the touchline on his left foot to give the Irish a very fortuitous win against Argentina from memory.
That's right, yeah. It was an excellent kicking display by Billy Dardis, or sorry, by Joey Carberry. Fraudulent slip there to get the Kildare connection, but Billy Dardis, if memory serves me right,
was turned over in a long floated pass out to Tom Fletcher. Fletcher pops it back inside to Stephen Murphy, the captain, but again, tenacious Clontarf defence. McCarthy pops it forward again. UCD are over, but the Clontarf man is lucky enough, maybe there.
He was definitely lingering there, wasn't he?
But there is an impressive Clontarf defence. They are up, they're tackling well. UCD are being driven back, and they're a fine tackle on the far side. And ball was knocked forward by UCD, and they made no. In fact, they went backwards there throughout that little phase of play, as the rain appears to be getting heavier here as we look out from our shelter position.
It is getting heavier, and yeah. The players are going to have to get used to them, I'm afraid, because this looks like it's down for the night.
And on comes number 18 for Clontarf, the 40 years young David Moore, who has been a great servant to Clontarf throughout the years, with their acute shortage of front rows due to the guys being away with Leinster, the call-ups. He's helping out, and he's come on to replace Dylan Doyle in the front row. And it'll be interesting to see now with this scrum. Obviously, Andy Wood, the Clontarf coach, has taken the decision he's going to try and stabilise this scrum, because if he doesn't, he was risking the possibility of a yellow card against his tight head, who has gone under a lot of pressure from a very impressive Andrew Porter, who was at the Junior World Cup as well this year. There were rumours that he might have been moving somewhere else, but thankfully for UCD, they didn't come to anything, and he's had a fine start to this Ulster Bank League season with college.
Yeah, we have a hold up here while Donal Lawler, the open side flanker, former St. Michael's College schoolboy, receives attention, but he's taken his place in the back row again for UCD as they square up for this Clontarf scrum.
So we're entering the final 5 minutes of normal time, but obviously the referee will have. There's been a couple of injury hold ups, so I would guess we might have the guts of 8 minutes, Dermot, still to go.
Yeah, I would.
I see you playing with your Twitter account there. Have you any other updates from the matches tonight?
I just see that the Leinster under-20s have a 6-point lead against Munster at half-time, or approaching half-time. Sorry, it's Munster who lead, sorry. Munster lead 9-3 approaching half-time, that game in the Mardyke. But I'm searching for AILs. 36 minutes, Belvo lead Terenure by 13-5, which is another Friday night game in Division 1A.
And we saw, I think, earlier on that Belvedere are turning out in their new blue home kit.
Yeah, that'll be interesting.
I wonder will any of their long-suffering supporters recognise them?
Clontarf have managed to gather a high kick ahead. They're in possession on the halfway line. Ball back to Carberry. Nudges it. Nice little punt into the 22, into touch, and it'll be a fine attacking position for Clontarf. And it must have got a touch because Clontarf are claiming it.
Yep.
Touch judge has indicated it's a Clontarf ball, and we have a little bit of argy-bargy.
Yes, the game is boiling nicely, I think one could say. There's been a few little occasions now when players are just keen to get the summer rust out of their system and shake a shoulder at their opposite number.
and maybe they just need to keep warm in the damp conditions.
But Sean Gallagher is a very experienced AIL referee now. Refereed very well in the British and Irish Cup last year. Could possibly have gone a bit higher, but one of his problems was that he was a school teacher in Bray, and he had problems getting release on a Friday to travel abroad. He has now changed profession. He's gone as a full-time referee development officer based over in Galway, and hopefully that means now as a full-time RFU employee, he will have the time to referee whenever he's appointed.
Ooh!
The ball has moved less. Ball has been moved left there by.
It's a number of shrill whistles by referee Sean Gallagher there to try and break up.
Yeah, there was an unfortunate high tackle over on the far side, Dermot. And the Clontarf players have taken exception to that. They're very quick to take exception to anything that is happening out there.
It'll be interesting to see what happens, because the ref was playing an advantage for an infringement on the 22 in front of the post. So does he stay with that decision, or does he maybe have a reverse or chat? Because there was certainly a lot going on there. But he's speaking to one of the UCD players. He seems to be happy that everything is under control. Joey Carberry has the ball on the 22, looking if he's all set to kick for goal. I think that's the decision that we're sticking with.
Certainly positional-wise, Dermot, the advantage would be to play it in the middle of the high tackle that we saw on the Clontarf player was much further over towards the touchline. So having already been playing advantage in the middle, the referee is right to stick with what would be the easier kicking position for the team with the advantage.
Anyway, Carberry is lining this up. It's, I suppose, by his standards on a normal day, it would be very straightforward, very easy, but the rain is still coming down on what is not a very pleasant evening by any stretch of the imagination in Belfield, or probably all over the country from what I believe.
Yes, I don't think it reached the north of Ireland quite yet, but it's due to get up there tomorrow. I think there'll be a lot of very wet grounds for the remainder of the All-Ireland Ulster Bank League matches tomorrow, as Carberry lands that simple shot for him to give Clontarf an 11-6 lead as we enter the last few seconds of normal time in the first half. The additional time now is at the referee's dispensation.
Yeah, I imagine there'll be 3 or 4 minutes anyway, because there have been a number of stoppages, Gordon, and I'm sure UCD would like to get back into it before the break. So the ball is gathered by Tony Ryan, who is tackled about 30 metres from his own line.
But I think, Dermot, we could say that Clontarf are full good measure for this lead. When they've had the ball, they've used it very well, despite the conditions. They've tried to move the ball. They put width on it. They obviously have the pace of the McGraths out in the wing. But I've been very impressed with the halfbacks, O'Mara and Carberry. They've linked very well. It's a lovely service from O'Mara, and Carberry's taken full advantage of that there. UCD rip it out again, but again it's one man just there on his own, and they're not really showing any way through. The ball's moved out to Doherty. Murphy goes round the neck of the Clontarf player, and again Mick McGrath's in very quickly on it. Little chip kick down into the corner. McGrath goes back, but the wind has blown it back, and he safely can fall on it. The referee looks at his watch. He looks at his second watch, and he blows for half time. So we've only actually had, Dermot, maybe about 60 seconds there. So at halftime here in Belfield, the score is UCD 6, Clontarf 11. Hopefully you will join us again in a few minutes after the 5-minute halftime break.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we're looking forward to it. Putting in a good few hard yards there in the pre-season. We know got a big ask against Clontarf, but we're looking forward to it Friday night.
Yeah, so we've got a live stream. It's the opening game of the season. Hoping to get a big crowd?
Yeah, hoping to get a big crowd in the bowl. Numbers picking up at the end of last year, so first game of the season. I know Clontarf always bring a good few over from Castle Avenue, so I'm expecting a big crowd in the day.
In terms of performance last year, were you happy with what you did and achieved?
Not really, to be honest. Like, we finished mid-table. It's not really acceptable, and we're looking to push forward this year, maybe get in the top four spot and secure the playoff place.
Have you changed anything?
We've got new coaching staff in this year. Obviously, new captain, and there's a few new personnel in as well in the team. So there's actually a few changes this year.
Well, hopefully we go that extra point further, pretty much. So obviously we won it the season before, put a big focus last year on going back to back, played in nearly every single game we could have played in, a couple of three finals, and Lansdowne just got the better of us the last time. So obviously it's back to the drawing board, more hard work, but building upon the foundations we've laid over the last few years.
What sort of a summer have you had?
A fair bit of work now. I think we started back early July, a couple of new sort of a new strength and conditioning coach, a few new faces, so a little bit of a freshen up from previous years, but all very good.
Looking into the first game of the season then, expectations and hopes?
Yeah, we'd have to go out and perform to our best ability, and I think if we do that, we should beat UCD. We played them a couple of weeks ago in the Leinster League, and quite a tight game. I think it was the first game for both, so kind of ironing out a few bits from the summer, but they won there 12-3, so hopefully reverse that on Friday.
What does Friday Night Lights bring to the Ulster Bank League?
I think it's just a bit more excitement. You know, you tend to get a better crowd. They're typically against the Dublin Derby, so you kind of know the players a bit better. And it's nice to kind of, get out under lights and have something a little bit different.
Warren says streaming very stop start, frustrating. Okay, good to go.
And welcome back to Belfield for the second half of this initial Ulster Bank League match of the season, where Clontarf lead UCD by 11 points to 6, and as Sean Gallagher blows the whistle, Clontarf kicked off to Joey Carberry, who's had a fine game to date, kicked very well, and UCD won the ball back, number 22. I think this is going to be a tough ask now for UCD, Darrell, who we think are playing into the elements to a certain extent.
Yeah, despite their strong scrummaging, they've been very much second best throughout the park, and there's the block down by Clontarf, and I suppose the Clontarf defence has been really impressive. They've been up very fast, and they're just snuffing out any threat that UCD seem to pose, and UCD unfortunately knock on their own 22, referee playing an advantage as Clontarf try to make something of the knock-on. It's ball is with Carberry, who spots a gap. Is well tackled by, double tackled. But unfortunately for Clontarf, O'Mara knocks on at the base of the ruck, and UCD get a scrum.
It was a good little cut there by Carberry. He went between two, and a good support play by his two centres. Stephen Murphy, the captain, and Colin Doherty come in, did the clearing out. But as you say, Dermot, there was this knock-on at the base of the scrum on this wet night, and again, the ball boy gives a fresh dry ball into the UCD scrum half, Nick McCarthy. It was interesting there, Dermot, at half time. We were joined here in the box by the Sunday Independent rugby correspondent, Brendan Fanning, who is now coaching the Clontarf under 20 team. He's been involved with the side, bringing them up through the 10s, and we're now at 17s, but he stepped aside from that. And it's great to see someone who spends a lot of time obviously watching provincial and international rugby was here supporting his club on a wet, miserable night like this.
Yes, and he was able to tell us about Dylan Doyle, the prop forward, the tight head prop for Clontarf, who was replaced by the 40-year young Davy Moore just before half time. Dylan was captain of the 20s in Clontarf last year, and I'll just hold that as a Clontarf attack. Down the right flank was Karen Mordner, blindside, who carried. This time it's with O'Mara, who tries sniping around the side. Referee has his arm out playing an advantage. I'm not sure what it was for. It might have been for a high tackle. But it's O'Mara at the base of the next ruck as the Clontarf attack inside the 22. Moving the ball right to left. Now they go back again, and the ball is knocked forward by O'Mara, but the referee is coming back for a penalty. He was playing an advantage, and it's a penalty inside the 22, and it's for going in from the side.
Illegal entry into the ruck, yeah. And it's noticeable, Dermot, that UCD are just starting to fall off tackles a little bit. The power of the Clontarf back five in the scrum, on a night like this, when you have that kind of power and they're driving forward, it does make it difficult for the defenders. And I think we'll find Joey Carberry and Dermot O'Mara, the halfbacks, probably trying to play the game down in the UCD half and then let their power runners take over from there.
And while Carberry lines up this kick, I'll just finish off that little story that Brendan was telling us about Dylan Doyle, that he was he's a converted prop forward. He's a second row. He was captain of their under-20s last year, and this was his AIL debut, his Ulster Bank League debut for Clontarf, and I suppose hopefully he won't be soured by his first experience of front row play, and that he'll learn from it and blossom into a fine player. Well struck by Carberry, but it comes off the right hand upright. Oh, and a missed kick. I should actually say a missed kick. I think he completely missed it, Gordon, yeah. Didn't he?
It was, and it was the Adrian Darcy, the Clontarf flanker, who came in with that tackle. A fine tackle, very good timing. He was literally trying to kick, and the referee now, I think, has had enough of the shenanigans between the two sides. He's called the two captains together, number 5 for Clontarf, Ben Riley, and the number 13 for UCD, Stephen Murphy. I would say he's going to ask them to have a word of the sides and just to cool them down. It's been a good game to date. We don't want to see either side lose a man to the bin, because that could be disastrous for the result of this match. And that fine tackle by Adrian Darcy has given Clontarf a very good attacking position. In fact, Dermot, I could be seeing Adrian Darcy again tomorrow because I'm due to umpire a Leinster Senior League cricket match. And Adrian Darcy's had a wonderful season with Clontarf and could well win the what's called the Marchant Cup for batting. He has gone so well. So he'll be hoping to come through this match injury-free to be able to play for Clontarf tomorrow.
Weather permitting.
Yes, well, it is down the road, and with the forecast tonight, I think I might have a long day of sitting around doing nothing.
So despite the scrum being disrupted, Clontarf retain possession. And the ball is turned over, and it's cleared. Jamie Glynn with a long kick downfield for UCD. And suddenly Clontarf are back inside their own half. Ball is charged down. It's taken on by Grinnell. Quick release out to the number six, Josh Murphy. And suddenly UCD are 10 metres from the Clontarf line.
It was very good hands by Jamie Glynn, the UCD out half, who popped the ball up to his flanker there. That's typical UCD. They can be under pressure and then they suddenly get a break. They kick long downfield.
And it was, I think it was Josh Murphy who blocked the Clontarf clearance. He then combined with Grinnell, with Glynn, to work a position into the corner. They got a penalty and they're after kicking into the corner. So they'll have a line out 5 metres from the Clontarf line. So it's their first, I think it's their first really good attacking position of the evening, Gordon.
I think so. It'll be interesting. Obviously, it's difficult on a wet night like this to get, you know, good handling. They've gone to the front. They just about got it. Ball's put out to Glynn, who spots a gap, goes through. He stopped about 5 metres short from the line.
Yeah, it was
McCarthy
a good tackle.
Pops out again.
It was a good tackle by Tony Ryan that stopped him short, and I think he's feeling the effects of it. But it's carried on by College. They're all over Clontarf now at the moment, inside the 5 metre line. Can they finish it off? Yes, it's a try. I'm not sure who scored, but it came from persistent pressure.
It was one of the big fours, and we're still trying to sort out who it was. I think it was a Donald Lawler over here as being his name. It's this big man here. We haven't seen his number yet, but we think it could be the back row forward. And that has really brought the crowd to life here. It's a sparse crowd on an evening like this, despite the fact that the College were advertising free food for bona fide students who turned up. There's a pig roast out the back of the main stand here. There haven't been that many who come. But could it be Brian Cawley, the captain, number four? I think it could have been.
I think it is Cawley. Yeah. Of course, he won't turn around and show us his number, but I think it is Cawley. It is Cawley, in fact. Yeah, I just see him walking away now. So Brian Cawley with the try.
Conal Doherty with a strike. Yes, there's cheers from the stand. Tell us UCD are happy there. And suddenly we have a ball game. UCD have gone 2 points ahead, 13 points to 11.
Yes, with 32 minutes to play. It's a 2-point lead for UCD. So that certainly was, let's say it was against the run of play. Clontarf had all the play. A good kick downfield, a charge down, some nice interpassing, penalty, kick to touch, and persistent work by the forwards resulted in Cawley getting the try, and Doherty slots the conversion to put the students 2 points in front.
But how often have we said over the years, Dermot, a try for College against the run of play. Past masters at that, even in this modern game. Ball fed back, Carby kicks. Barry Daly tries to play football with it, doesn't manage it. Gets a long kick down. Joey Carby is back there. He's going to launch this long, I suspect. Can he get it to bounce? No, it's gone straight in. It has gone straight in. So now a line out will be deep inside the Clontarf half as we see number 17, Liam Oak Murphy. entering the fray for Clontarf. The ex-young Munster, he's replaced number six, Carl Moran. I think Liam Ogue was a USA originally, Dermot. That was somewhere in my memory bank. Certainly transferred from Young Munster when he came back to the States a couple of years ago. And was kind of a bench player last season. Referee Sean Gallagher's hand out for another penalty to UCD as they go right. Really, they're going nowhere again. The fast lines, yep. The fast line speed of UCD, and but quite rightly, Sean Gallagher wants to take him to the right place, and this will be a penalty about just over 30 metres out. I was about to say kickable, but no, Stephen Murphy's decided to go for the corner. They're going to try and repeat what they did a couple of minutes ago the last time down here in this game. Dermot has turned it on his head.
It sure is. I mean, I would have thought that was kickable. Of course, the previous one was kickable as well, but I suppose after getting success once from a line-out, maybe they're intent on trying again, and let's see how they do. So it's going to be Sean McNulty, another Irish under 20 international, who is taking the throw, goes to the back. It's a bit scrappy, but the students have managed to somehow snag the ball, and they peel around the right-hand side of the ruck.
Funny, the last line-out down here, Dermot, was a bit scraggy as well, and they scored off it. But they're not making quite the progress this time. It's not quite as well constructed. But Glyn goes, he looks to pop it up. He's well taken down. Front of the UCD posts, about 20 metres out. The ball's been knocked forward. And that UCD are under a lot of pressure, Dermot, in the line-out. Clontarf are competing well. As we see, the number 17 for UCD, Gordon Frain, coming on. Ex-Clongo schoolboy.
I think probably the difference in the two attacks was in the previous one, Glyn made a break, 8, 9 yards, 10 yards towards the Clontarf 5 metre line, and that set up the try. But on that last occasion, he was stopped in his tracks, close enough back to the 22. So then the ball was knocked on. So Glyn, first time made the break, that time he was stopped short. And the rain seems to be getting heavier again, Gordon. And just a couple of half times from around the league. I know we're 13 minutes into the second half, but Old Belvedere in their new colours were leading last year's beaten semi-finalists Terenure College 13-8. In Division 1B, Trinity were leading 9-3 at half time in Stradbroke away to Blackrock College. And in Division 2B, in Home Patrick's, Gary's the home team, were losing 16-0 at halftime against Naas.
Just an update now, I see here, Belvedere now lead Terenure 20-8, and Ure have missed a penalty quite recently.
Also approaching halftime, Connacht were losing 23-3 away to Glasgow Warriors. And in the under 20 Interpro at halftime, it was 9-3 for Munster at home, and the Mardyke and Cork against Leinster.
Good fast pressure by UCD there on Joey Carby, but he gets a good kick away, and that will bring play up to about 5 metres short of the...
The ref wants a player looked at. I think he got a bang, but Gordon, to go back to there's a few other new... what would we say? Some new regulations around the All-Ireland League this year, I suppose, and the one that's maybe cause a lot of confusion is the player point system. So would you be able to elaborate on that a little?
Yeah, the player point system, again, was grew legs through the All-Ireland League review of the year before last. The IRFU and the branches, I would have been in regular contact with you about this, were very worried by the level of transfers between clubs. At one stage, we thought it might have been a lot for money. The Regulation 6 came in where you couldn't pay players, and yet the transfers were still going on. And it was breeding a lack of loyalty within the clubs. Another fantastic break here by Barry Daly through the middle of the play. He's still going. Oh, he's just knocked on 10 yards short of the post. Clontarf running the ball back out. They have the advantage from the knock-on. So if they don't get this, they have, and O'Mara, the good left-footed strike, takes the ball halfway between the 22 and the 10-metre line. Super break there by Barry Daly, Dermot.
Yeah, it was a lovely break because he found a little gap in traffic, cut out left, then made his way back into the right, got well inside the 22 before, unfortunately for College, knocking on about 10 metres from the line. And good clearance by O'Mara to relieve pressure on the North City side.
Fine take at the back of the line for UCD. But again, knock on, wet ball, frustrating for the players, unfortunately. It's a wet night, and we can only hope that this isn't the start of a long wet season. Dermot, I'll return to the PPS in a second, just while we keep this period of play going. The scrum on the far side of the pitch, put into UCD, or sorry, to Clontarf. Dermot O'Mara, whose good defensive kick has actually brought the play up to here. Clontarf are lined out in a good attacking formation. But again, Andrew Porter getting a lot of pressure on his man there. Clontarf's come in real trouble. But Anthony Ryan, I think it is, who's driven forward there off the back of it, has done very well. An isolated Clontarf man, he's done well to get the ball away. Carberry is just putting boot to ball, kicking long downfield to Billy Dardis. Good take from the former Ternier schoolboy. A little chip through. And Dardis looks a little bit amazed by that decision from Sean Gallagher. He was right in front of us. I think that was harsh. He did one of his traditional little chips. I've seen him do it for Irish schools and under 20s. He's magically quick on his feet. He tried to chip over to a couple of men. A Clontarf guy ran possibly a slight blocking line, Dermot. Dardis actually slipped more than anything else. And I think if this results in 3 points for Clontarf, it would be deemed to be a harsh decision.
Yeah, I must say I read it the same way as you did. I thought he was blocked, maybe intentionally, maybe not intentionally. I would have thought the penalty against him was very harsh. But anyway,
when the whistle went, I was expecting the penalty the other way, and I would have thought it harsh as well in that.
Anyway, Carberry has a chance to nudge Clontarf back in front. 45-meter penalty attempt. He strikes it well.
It's going to drop short. Caught by Dardis under the posts, and I'd say that's probably justice has been seen to be done there.
Well, I'm sure Dardis was delighted to see it dropping short. So it's still 13 points to 11 in favour of UCD, and they now have a dropout as in front of us here, number 16 for Clontarf, who is Brian Keelan. Looks like he's going to enter the fray, but not before a good clearing kick from Clontarf, and it has Billy Dardis. And UCD back deep inside their own 22. Dardis doesn't find touch. He does get the ball over the halfway line, and it's Carberry who comes forward. He slips, but he manages to offload the ball. And it's
Adrian Darcy driving forward there, distinctive white headband. Clontarf go left. They've gone wide of the UCD defence down the far side. And Magic Mick is away again.
Second try of the night for Magic Mick, but I think, in fairness to Magic Mick, the work was done by the likes of Adrian Darcy and his fellow forwards down the far side.
Yeah, it was a good switch by Tarf after the break by Darcy to the right, coming towards the camera here. They moved it swiftly back to the left. They had a lot of players on the left-hand side. They timed the pass well. UCD got outflanked quite easily on that side. There was one despairing tackle, and then the ball was popped to Magic Mick, who literally strolled in over the line. Having had to work so hard for the first try, I don't think that particular one, it would still be one of the good tries, Dermot, for the season.
Well, it's good because it puts Clontarf back in front.
But why do you think that's good?
Oh, sorry, it's good from Clontarf's point of view. I'm totally neutral. But certainly it didn't compare with the excitement of the first try that Magic Mick scored. And I see a couple of changes here while Carberry lines up his kick. Tim Mackay is replacing Rob Keogh at full back, number 20, Mackay. And Brian Keelan is also into the fray. Missing a
fine conversion and kick there by Joey Carberry. He really does strike the ball well, Dermot.
Yeah, he's a beautiful kicker. And Keelan has replaced Turlough Considine, the hooker for Clontarf. So Carberry, with the conversion, gives a 5-point advantage, 18 points to 13 for Clontarf.
At the midpoint of the second half. Considering the conditions, Dermot, it's been an enjoyable game. I've been very impressed by the attitude and ability of Clontarf to play rugby in these conditions, as Billy Dardis is nailed and he doesn't hold on to it, but the ball was knocked forward. There's an advantage being played by referee Sean Gallagher. If Clontarf can win this, they're driving forward. It's a powerful pack, even without their distinguished front row members who are away with Leinster. Ball is swung left again. This time it doesn't get as far as Mick McGrath on the wing, but UCD trying to hold this one up, but no, Clontarf driving forward. Good depth to the line here.
Nice move.
Carby making the break inside, and it's been knocked forward by UCD. Fine break forward by Brian Keelan there. The Rock Anderson UCD penalised for not rolling away. And here comes a card, unfortunately, for UCD. For interfering with play. And that could be the death knell for UCD in this game. Down to 14 against what has become a rather rampant UCD side, Dermot, in the last 5 minutes.
I think you mean rampant Clontarf, but it was certainly, I think it's Jamie Glynn who has been sin-binned. He's coming off there in front of us. Yeah, indeed, it is Glynn, so he'll have 10 minutes in the bin. But it was a tremendous chase on Dardis by Adrian Darcy. He tackled him, forced the knock-on, gave Clontarf possession. And again, I thought it was Carberry who was pulling the strings, moving the ball left and right, sniping where he saw a break. And the reward is a chance for Carberry to extend the lead from 5 out to 8 points.
Another substitution for UCD here, number 18, Alex Penny, the former St. Michael's schoolboy, has come on. And I think he is replacing, yes, the number 7, Donald Lawler, who took a bang in the first half, has soldiered on manfully, but with 17 minutes and 100 to go, he's been replaced, and I don't think he'll be back. He seems he's hobbling quite badly as Carby lines up this kick and chips it between the posts, and that makes it a two-score game now, 21 points to 13 in favour of UCD. Sorry, in favour of Clontarf. And with college down to 14 men, Dermot, I think this is going to be a monumental task for them to rescue anything from this game.
I would agree with that, Gordon. But as we speak, it's a knock-on by Clontarf, number 17, Liam O'Murphy, the former young Munster man, has knocked the ball on. So to give the students a foothold in Clontarf territory. And let's see what they can do here. They've been strong in the scrum there. And I'm trying to work out, is it Murphy, their captain, who appears to be gone in to the out half position to replace Glynn. Winger Barry Daly is on his left flank. UCD rescue a messy situation there. They were disrupted in the scrum, and they're just trying to establish a bit of a platform here, but they managed to drive forward about 5 or 6 yards. Ball comes out. They're still on the 22.
McCarthy probing for gaps, seeing him hitting the runners to try and put them through a gap. He's taking a couple of steps. He's signed a potential high tackle there. Yes, the referee is arm out, but he's here straight through the something. Middle. Great break up the middle there.
I think it was Gordon Frayne who made the break, the number 17. Still an advantage for the students, but I'm sure it's a try they'd rather than the 3 points. So they try to go around the fringe. Now they're going to move it. It's Murphy. But he's well tackled. He's going nowhere. And the referee is playing on. I wonder has he said advantage over Gordon.
In the modern game, I doubt it somehow. Although it'll be coming very close to it now. College will want to get something out of this because they want to get back within one score. McCarthy. I'd say it must be advantage over now.
Yeah. Yeah. There's no advantage there. They're back on the 22. Still probing though. Murphy with a big kick that is knocked on by UCD. It was a UCD player. I can't make out who it is, but a UCD player got into position there ahead of Mick McGrath, but unfortunately couldn't hold the ball.
Billy Dardis, was it?
So it's a 5 metre defensive scrum for Clontarf for the knock on.
No, it's Tom Fletcher, in fact, who almost got the better of Magic Mick down the left wing there. There was a plaintive shout from Clontarf people to our right here that it should be a 22 dropout, but that's incorrect under law. The knock on means it's a scrum from where the ball is knocked on, which was in the five, so it's a 5 metre defensive scrum. Now, interestingly, the last scrum, Dermot, Clontarf seemed to be stronger, which hasn't been the way the scrums have been this game. Interesting if UCD can turn this one around now.
Of course, the benches have been emptied here, so Dave Moore's experience should come into play for Clontarf. So the feed is for Tarf and O'Mara with the put in. Offside, I think, is it? Playing the ball ahead of the player. Yeah, it was knocked on and then it was played by a Clontarf player in an offside position. So a chance here for UCD. Are they going to take the points? No, they decide to go for a scrum. As our notes go all over the place with the swirling breeze here in Belfield. So still down a player. Clontarf UCD have a very good attacking position. Again, they have the full complement in the scrum. Stephen Murphy standing at out half. Conal Doherty outside him. Billy Dardis is standing in the outside centre position. And Barry Daly is hugging the touchline here on the left-hand side, which would make me wonder, is there a kick option here?
It's possible. It's taking time here to set this on our clock. 11 and a half minutes left in the game, plus injury time. UCD hold that scrum fairly well. They look like they're under pressure. They've picked to the back of the scrum. They're driving forward. A couple of yards short of the line. Again, good defence by Clontarf, who were told to roll away by the referee. UCD driving in under the post. They're sniping around the side, but again, good Clontarf defence, which has been a highlight of the game. Clontarf's defence has been excellent throughout the game.
I think that was McCarthy who took a little snipe around the side of the last ruck.
And referee Sean Gallagher, perfectly positioned over the line, signals that the ball was held up, and it's going to be another 5 metre scrum for UCD, who with only 14 men are doing extremely well.
Yeah, they did very well because Clontarf managed to disrupt the scrum a little bit, but UCD then rescued it, throw forward, and got over the line, but from their point of view, they couldn't get it down. So it remains an 8-point game. Clontarf lead 21 points to 13. We have a little over 10 minutes to go, and we have a stoppage for injuries.
Just looking here at a tweet in from Justin Deegan from the RFU. Dermot, he says, Gordon, Dermot, great job with match commentary, fellas. Great stream at videos on the net. So well done to John and the lads here behind.
Yes, it's, and I know we're in a lovely covered in box, commentary box, but up on top there's a cameraman who is doing a tremendous job, Brian. And well done, Brian, because Brian is not covered in. There's a little, I think there's a little bit of canvas separating him from the conditions, and I'm not sure if that's saving him.
So, another attacking 5 minute scrum. Pressure on from the Clontarf front row. Can UCD pick? It's a penalty for driving up in the scrum, which the Clontarf bench to our right disagree with. And UCD have decided they're going to try and take the points to get back within one score. Probably Dermot was 9.5 minutes ago.
Well, if they get back to within one score, they're in bonus point territory. At the moment, they're 8 points adrift, so they get nothing. So Doherty has kicked well tonight. He's a chance now to get them back to within 5 points. And with Glynn coming back on it shortly, they would hope that they could maybe stage a late charge for the win. But Doherty needs to get this first of all.
And interestingly, you can tell the pressure Dermot, the coach, is under. Andy Wood, the Kiwi coach of Clontarf, who's done an excellent job over the years there, was rather vocal in his criticism of the referee there on that decision.
Yeah, that's a good strike by Doherty, and we have a 5 point game. So a successful penalty with a little over 8 minutes to go. 21 points to 16 in favour of the visitors, Clontarf.
Jamie Glynn is stripping off his top, so I'd say after the next break and play, he'd probably be coming back on. That'll get them up to full confidence. They just have to. And the touch has said to the number four that it'll be the next break and play will be the end of the sin bin period. So, unusually, Dermot, the team in down to 14 have actually won this period of 10 minutes 3-0 so far.
Yeah, and they were, I suppose.
I hope I haven't spoken too soon, as Clontarf or UCD kind of run the ball back out. McCarthy probably will go for the box kick here again. Yep. Magic Mick is under it, and what can he manufacture here? He hoofs the ball left footed down the field.
This could be trouble.
It's a long kick. No. Is it going to go all the way? No, it's going to stop in. So now it'll be a 22 dropout. And I would suspect we'll see UCD back unless they try a quick one here. Don't give time. But Sean Gallagher is stopping play now. And Jamie Glynn is back from the bin. And Donald Lawler is back on as well. Number 7 from injury. And number 20 for UCD, Robert Keenan, ex-Black Rock schoolboy, is coming on as well. So, of course, Dermot, in the Ulster Bank League, we have rolling substitutions, so guys can come on and off. And it must work particularly well for someone like David Moore, 40 years young, who can still continue to play the game. He's can come on for 20 minutes or half an hour. When the lungs are giving out a bit, he can come off, be replaced, have a rest, and still come back on later on, and gives him some great enjoyment of the game that he obviously loves that he's played for so long.
Yeah, I mean, rolling subs has been a feature throughout most of the rugby in Ireland for the last number of years, or at club level. I think schoolboys might be the only level where it's not a feature, but as we watch UCD come forward, however they turn the ball over on the deck, I see Billy Dardis has just gone off for UCD, so that's a serious attacking weapon on the bench. But it's talking of big Davy Moore, he just manages to get a few yards forward for Clontarf. A nice reverse pass, and it's the Clontarf bench who are very much to the fore. It was Lee Moog Murphy linking with Tim Mackay after Moore had created the initial surge. So it's Clontarf in the van at the moment. McGrath, Magic Mick goes forward, but unfortunately for him, he spills the ball. And it's a chance for the students to see can they attack from inside their own 22. But A knock on by Clontarf is what the referee is calling for after UCD couldn't gain any advantage. So with a little over 5 minutes to go, we have another stoppage in play. I see somebody getting treatment in midfield, but to return to the player point system, Gordon.
You're putting me under pressure again, are you?
Well, I think the last few minutes earn your big fee.
Very quickly, this looks like it could be an injury for a little bit of time here to UCD man. I was stretching himself on the ground. Yeah, the player point system was has been brought in to try and breed more club loyalty in the hope that if clubs are get a high number of points for players transferring to them, that they'll have to only have so many players on their panel. Each club has to 45 players on their panel, up to a maximum of 100 points. Now, the 100 points this year, in the first year, is quite a generous allowance, and I could see it being gradually reduced over the years to try and get as much loyalty as possible. But also built into it is the fact that, you know, players who have to move considerable distances for work purposes, that they wouldn't be penalised with a four-point transfer. The club who, say, the player transfers from Cork to Dublin or vice versa, the club can make application to the league committee for a reduction in the value of the points for that player. And that is, there have been quite a number of applications this year already.
While you were talking through that, it was a successful penalty kick from Carberry to re-establish the eight-point lead for Clontarf. And Clontarf have taken off Dermot O'Mara.
He's had a fine game, Dermot.
And replaced him with Andrew Feeney, I think, who was a Setonians player. Was Setonians under 20s player, if I'm not mistaken, last year.
So the clock showing 3.5 minutes, Dermot plus injury. It's now an 8-point game again. Good challenge there, Donald Lawler, who's on a knock on. This thing's getting a little bit scrappy here. Clontarf get the scrum in midfield. And at almost every break now, Dermot, there's an injury, somebody's down. Obviously, the guys who have put a lot of work in over the summer in their fitness, and the game has been played at a good tempo throughout. So obviously the work that the players have done has been very impressive. And I think overall, Dermot, with 3 minutes to go of normal time, this has been a good start to the Ulster Bank League.
Well, absolutely. I mean, the conditions are atrocious. It hasn't stopped raining throughout the game. It started raining around 3 or 4 o'clock here in Dublin this afternoon. And for the players to put on the show they have put on, I suppose, for me anyway, and I'm sure for you and for everybody here, it's Mick McGrath's magical try in the first half that we will cherish for many a long day and evening.
And I'm sure that John and his company Videos Net will, when they put the highlights program up, will highlight that try and maybe even get a couple of replays of it, of Magic Mick storming down the left-hand touchline for that early season try.
And Old Belvedere have beaten Terenure. I don't see a score, but I see the Terenure Twitter account is congratulating Old Belvedere on their win. So it's a 27-8 in favour of Old Belvedere against Terenure in Division 1A. So it looks like Old Belvedere have started with a win, and I suppose it's odds on that Clontarf are going to join them in the win column after the two Division 1A games this evening.
And just looking at Twitter here as well, Dermot, Munster, and there's a big turnaround in the game from a UCD scrum who were totally dominant in the first 6 minutes of the game. They have just been demolished in that scrum there by Clontarf.
Yeah, it's a big turnaround, all right. And
high fives all around the Clontarf pack for that. Just word from Cork, the Marlach Arena, Munster under 20s lead Leinster by 19-8 with 15 minutes to go. As Clontarf, Carby kicks long into the corner to give Clontarf an attacking line out about 15 metres out. A try here would certainly seal the game for them. I'm just scanning the Twitter accounts today to see if there's any other scores in.
Clontarf taking their time to take their positions for this line-out. They lead by 8 points. There's less than 2 minutes on the clock. The ball is overthrown, but somehow it's gathered in at the tail by, I think it was Adrian Darcy. And Clontarf drive forward. Feeney, the replacement scrum half, feeds Moore.
Clontarf player down this side, suffering with cramp as Carby Jinks. He's through, pop it inside.
And it's the attacking team that were penalised for holding on.
Yeah.
Just when it looked as if they were going to completely seal the game and put the game totally beyond UCD, they're penalised within 5 metres of the UCD line.
Good kick to touch by Collins here. It was a fine break by Joey Carby. Popped the ball inside to Carl Moran. But again, Moran was isolated and a good turnover for College. And College player hobbles off with what I think is cramp. It's been a long, hard night for the two packs in these conditions on a super surface. Belfield Bowl looks an absolute picture. The lights look well.
Well, this one the officials have completely missed. That sort of went down about 2 yards left of the line-out line. But Clontarf in possession.
Yeah, it was Ben Riley, the Clontarf captain, who hobbled off. I think it's nothing more than a bad bit of cramp. He was down the far side. Clontarf still driving forward, Coramore again. Ball is fed out. Carvey, a lovely slippers ball, and that's completely bamboozled the UCD defence there. Number 11, Barry Daly, tried to play soccer with it, and unfortunately, I don't think he'd be selected, Dermot, for the UCD football club who play here in some of their matches.
Well, I think luckily for him, it bounced over his leg completely. He didn't touch it because UCD have the line out. But a player that was very much in the van there for Clontarf was Tony Ryan. Tony would be familiar with junior rugby in the province. He's from Enniscorthy, and he would have featured on a very successful Enniscorthy team over the last few years. He would have been on their Towns Cup winning team 3 years ago, and also on the team that won the All-Ireland Junior Cup in Coolmine against Clare Valley the season before last. And he has gone on, and he is playing. He played a central part in Clontarf's successful season last year, where they finished runners-up. And Clontarf continuing to keep the students pegged back. We're into injury time, and I think UCD would just hope that maybe they can somehow snag a bonus point. And line out, knock on option here for UCD. I think they're going to go for
referee's giving them an option of a knock on or something. UC opt for a scrum, which after the way they were demolished in the last scrum is maybe a brave call. They want to finish with a big one.
Yes, I think we both were a little bit surprised by that call, because they seemed to be set up for the line-out, and then somebody said, no, we'll take the scrum. And
they still have the first-choice props on Andrew Porter and Liam Hyland. Sub-hooker Gordon Frayne. And the 40 years young Dave Moore is still packing down a tight head for Clontarf here. And the referee is not happy and pulls it up.
He's talking to Davey Moore. Do you think he's listening? I think he has his mind set on disruption here, so it'll be interesting to see how Moore goes against Porter. We have a great view of that battle on this side of the scrum. Moore looks to be in control. Well, the scrum was disrupted, and Clontarf have done the damage again. They've turned it over. A strike against the head.
And it was a fine drive up up the side. Up, oh no, it's finished with two players here, lads. The final whistle's gone. Don't do anything silly now. Don't give me any disciplinary work to do, please.
Well, it's full time here in Belfield. Clontarf have won by 24 points to 16. And it's the first win of the season for Clontarf. They beat UCD twice last season in the league, and they've continued where they finished off with a solid 8-point victory. Well deserved, Gordon.
Yes, indeed. The referee is having a word with a couple of players there. I think actually he has. Maybe this isn't over yet. The Clontarf number one, Andrew Porter, and the 18, Davy Moore, have been pulled to one side of the referee. He's still speaking to them. And telling them there's no need for that there. Hopefully it'll just be a stern talking to and play the game. And they shake hands, hug each other, and teams leave the field. So yes, a fine advertisement for Ulster Bank League Division 1A Rugby Dermot. Clontarf have got a good victory on the road to start their season off with. They look delighted themselves. They're all patting and hugging each other. And it was a cracking game of rugby. We hope that you've all enjoyed it from wherever you are in the world. And we hope to see you again sometime in the near future for another night of Friday Night Lights Ulster Bank Rugby.